With us in the union is the UNILAG chairman of Academic Staff Union of Universities, Adelaja Odukoya. It's good to have you in the studio right now.
Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Now, let us have an understanding of why there was a need in the first place to introduce the issue of the post-UTME.
If there is a need.
If there is the need, then we can understand maybe why the somersault, the change in frequent change in policies as the case may be.
Thank you very much. The first thing is to note that the issue of the post-UTME is a child of necessity. Hitherto, we had an admission system fully automated by the JAMB Matriculation Board, Joint Admission Matriculation Board. And over the year, as university administrators, as lecturers, we have seen that the product that comes into the university system are not as credible as they are supposed to be in terms of the success ratio. I happen to be a course advisor for a number of years before and after we start this new system. The experience has been that students who are supposed to have scored above 300 and above in the JAMB exams thrown into the university system always find it difficult to even survive our first semester. And the question you ask is that, how do they get here in the first instance? Two, we have had instances where even the Minister of Education actually raised serious question mark about the integrity of JAMB examination. So it was against this background that there becomes a need for university to actually intervene. And ultimately, a university is as good as the students you send to them. And if our universities are to be globally competitive, we must be able to attract quality students that can actually do serious academic and scholarship.
So really the post-UMTE is a way of weeding out the weak, so as it were, is that it?
Yes, to ensure, and of course today, equally in the last few years too, we equally have a situation in Nigeria where in the education sector, because of desperation, anything goes. We have a situation all over our streets. We have what we call the miracle centers. Even WAEC has special centers, JAMB has special center, where people are awarded undeserved marks.
But the rationale of the federal government is that at times, even the university itself, they are not as honest as one would expect them to be.
The federal government is just making an allegation without proof. We have on ground situation. We can give you facts as to, for example, University of Ibadan, for instance, have done a study, public study, about as to what is the percentage of dropouts from the first year from those admitted during solely on JAMB examination and after. And we have seen a reduction from about 40% to about less than 3%. So let the federal government come out and tell us in this university they are not being credible. So, but we are saying that even beyond that, we have a situation whereby students that would otherwise have gotten to the university system have been excluded because their parents are not able to either pay money in the special center, pay money to JAMB officials, and of course, go back. Your station have reported many times, severally, and it's all over the newspaper. What happens at JAMB centers?
So couldn't the university have administered those examinations without charging the candidate some fee? Maybe
the
that's
issue is even for the federal government not charging. Even the new policy equally admits that you must charge a benchmark of 2,500. And you see, when equally talks about charging, this is a university that institution that the federal, they are poorly funded. I can tell you, especially at the level of state universities, I don't want to start mentioning state. There are several states that have not even given university subvention, the university in their state, subvention in the last 15 months. And the governments are going ahead to even establish other universities.
Okay.
And when you have to conduct this thing, there are logistics, there are things that would, the university is not making money to post-UTME, but rather the cost of the service being rendered.
Okay. Now, is this to say, because you've given us a background, but is this to say that the universities don't have confidence and trust in
absolutely.
The
The integrity of the JAMB exam is in doubt.
Are you calling for JAMB to be scrapped?
As a matter of fact, the JAMB has no business in this business of admission in the first instance.
Oh, really?
It is part of what we call the bottle federalism that we have. JAMB, for instance, education is on the concurrent list. Beyond a national regulatory body that sets standards and parameters, what business have JAMB to start regulating, or the Minister of Education to start regulating what happened in a state university?
So what is really happening in Nigeria, and they are flouting the constitution, really?
Yes, yes. And let me quickly tell you, we said we want to be globally competitive. We say our universities are not one of the first 1,000 in the world. Who admit for Harvard University? Who admit for all these other Oxford University? Is there a central admission body that admits for them? Each university is an autonomous body. The idea of our university is universal practices.
Right.
So the university must have the freedom and autonomy to admit those students in the field. They can train.
Yeah,
to
but in the case where the Joint Admission and Matriculation Board is an establishment of the Act of the National Assembly, and universities are coming up with an examination system that equates or a replica that is the similar process of what JAMB is doing, isn't that constitutional from the side of the universities, or a duplication of what the constitution has said?
The first thing is that every university has its own senate, and the senate is the ultimate authority on issue of academics affair in every university.
Okay.
In terms of admission and awarding of degree, the JAMB is not the university senate. So that's where the JAMB has no business in the issue of admission in the first instance. And
right.
I just told you what is happening in Harvard or any other university country across the world. You don't admit for universities. We train them. We should be able to say, just like, for example, is there anybody admitting for you, employing for you in
TBC?
Is there any outside body recruiting for political parties? Even when intellectualism is not even involved there.
So are you really appalled now by this new policy of the catchment and the point?
The issue of even catchment, educationally disadvantaged area, is superfluous. How many years after independence we are still talking about educationally disadvantaged area and things like that? And this is part of what we call the problem of this, our federalism. People and when you see the state of the Nigerian state in terms of economy, in terms of the state of being unable to actually pay salary, you see, it's this part of this over-reliance on the central. States and everybody should be allowed to actually chart their own paths. Universities are autonomous bodies to train high-quality manpower and to determine those who they want to train, those and how they want to train them at any point in time. JAMB has no business in admission students for the university.
Okay, now let's come to the issue of the policy somersault. The issue of JAMB has been on for so many years, and eventually a Minister of Education comes, or an administration comes, and then we say, okay, well, we're scrapping post-UTME, and then after 3 months again, no, we're restarted. Why is there that somersault of policy or decision, as the case may be?
Let me preface that by equally reminding you about the somersault that even JAMB itself, two sections ago, came up with. JAMB suddenly become a marketing body for private university and start talking about university that undersubscribes. Are we not supposed to be running a capitalist system no matter how decadent it is? Is it not supposed to be a law of demand and supply? If the private university is as good as they are, why are they not attracting students? So, I'm talking about the policy somersaults. It's just unfortunate that we plan without facts, and we have a kind of political elite that has a pathological hatred for knowledge. We don't do research. If they have done research, and that's what's actually happening on almost all facets of our national life, if research has been conducted, and I've just told you, you can find out, University of Ibadan have done point system. What is the point system? UI was using the point system. It failed. They have abandoned it.
Can you explain that point system to us, really?
Oh, it's in the open domain by JAMB. Anyway, they started by saying what you are. Of course, too, they have equally, within the same framework, said they are not actually using that and that. But when they talk about the point system, what they're saying is that the scores you have at the WAEC level will have a point. If you have an A, there's a point. Maybe let's just hypothetically say
10 points, A1 to A3, if you have a B, 5 points, and so on and so forth. So what that equally means is that you have, and we have a situation where we say we have people who have special centers for even like
Miracle centers.
So what you say is that the fraudulent process for admission will now continue and will start at the level of
so people can
amass enough points
without meriting it. Really.
Without meriting, that's one. Then two, the score you equally have with your jump equally matter. 180 to 200 at its own point, 200 to maybe 230, and so on and so forth. So, of course, to that, it becomes a situation of the highest bidder. So that's actually the point system. But I'm telling you, you have tried this system. They've done the research on it. It has failed. So why will a government, and that's the problem. We have a government which does not believe in using intellectual academics. And situation that we have actually found solution to or have been done, you still keep on recycling it. So these are ill-digested, ill-thought-of ideas. And what do you have? Like you rightly said, some few weeks, months down the line, we'll come back to you. This thing becomes a vicious circle.
Okay, we'll come back to this. Let's give our viewers a background to understanding some aspects of this. Now, the Joint Admissions Matriculation Board was formed by a decree of the federal government during the tenure of General Olusegun Obasanjo in 1979. It was established by Act No. 2 of 1978 of the Federal Military Government on 13 February 1978.
In 1974, Nigeria had only 7 universities, each conducting its own entrance exams, but the system placed serious limitations on potential candidates. But the problem worsened when, by 1976, the then Federal Military Government, under the leadership of General Olusegun Obasanjo, established 6 additional universities.
Now, consequently, the government set up a committee which recommended the setting up of the Joint Matriculation Board. And by August 1988, the Federal Executive Council amended Decree No. 2 of 1978 to empower the board to conduct matriculation examinations for entry into all polytechnics and colleges for education in the country.
The amendment have since been codified into Decree No. 33 of 1989. Which took effect from 7th December 1989. The advent of private universities and creation of more state universities between 1999 and early 2000 gave rise to the need for universities to conduct internal examination for students seeking admission in universities.
Now, the UTME policy was introduced into the Nigerian university system during the Obasanjo administration in 2005. At that time, the cutoff mark was between 180 and 200, yet the other condition for admission was predicated on passing the university's own examination, that's the post-UTME. Now, let's come to Adelaja here. We have heard several reports of universities abusing the post-UTME examination system. Sometimes female students are harassed, sometimes monies are demanded from different male students for them to gain admission and all of that. We've had such kind of cases. So if that has become recurrent, as it has been in the news, would you still see that as justifiable?
The issue of harassment of students, or anybody for that matter, is a global problem. And it is, I'm not aware if the issue you were talking about is the Barua case that we have in UNILAG. Barua even happened not to be a lecturer of UNILAG. It's a settled fact. And of course, everybody knows the format and or the platform for actually admission. Like I tell people in, for example, I can talk of the University of Lagos. I'll tell you the admission of University of Lagos is strictly on merits. As a matter of fact, even as a lecturer, most of us as lecturers, our children end up actually doing what we call foundation exam, because if you cannot make the benchmark, you don't get it. So the issue of, and that tells you how transparent the system is, if your child cannot make the cutoff mark of University of Lagos, and you can quote me, even if you are a student or a lecturer at University of Lagos, you cannot get it. Mm. You have to either go to another university or you go through what we call the foundation program. Mm. So it is as good as that. So this issue is like giving a dog a bad name to hang it. You understand? It's just like talking about the National Assembly or the executive in terms of corruption. Are you because of corruption? You say because of the issue of corruption, you are scrapping the National Assembly? And these issues are not true. The issue is we are talking about integrity of the of JAMB itself. And of course, the last JAMB, it's even amazing. The last JAMB is one of the most ridiculous and incredible of the all exams that we have had.
Okay.
We have a situation where even scores are awarded to students. The computer was not working, and so on and so forth.
Okay. I like to have an understanding of the concept of catchment. We certainly know that it has to do with groupings of some states or whatever. But what determines a catchment area for a candidate who is sitting for this exam?
Okay, catchment has to talk about, and that's constitutionally for me, it is discriminative. Catchment has to do about proximity to a university, locationality. For example, University of Lagos, catchment area, the surrounding states are deemed to be catchment to this thing. So students who are from those areas like Ogun, Ondo, Oyo, and maybe doing some this thing, are deemed to be catchment to Lagos. So because they are close, they are proximate to Lagos.
So are they giving priority?
Oh yes. So for example, the admission might be for I won't be too specific now. Let's say merit. That's what the JAMB could be. Let's say 40 or 50%. If you have maybe 200 and above or whatever based on that course, then catchment may be 10%. The other may be they just allocate it. So specific percentage. So if the percentage for merit has been filled, even when you have more than those on catchment area, this one will actually be lower than the merit. The merit candidate will be left out, where the catchment will be taken.
Mm.
The merit candidate will be left out, where the educationally disadvantaged area will be taken. For example, let me give you a scenario. In post science, for example, the cutoff mark is 260. So if you have 259, you will not get admission.
Mm.
The person from educationally disadvantaged area, the cutoff mark is 210. That person will get admission. Wow. Ahead of the two, that is what the Minister of Education has postponed.
Wow.
All right, so I think we have more information to churn out. All right, so we'll go on.
Yes, certainly. Now, Education Minister Adamu Adamu says there is confidence in JAMB's conduct of the Unified Tertiary Matriculation Examinations as a UTME. Hence, there is no need for the post-UTME.
The Joint Admissions and Matriculation Board, JAMB, and tertiary education stakeholders have adopted 180 as the cutoff mark for 2016 admission into universities, polytechnics, and colleges of education. Prior to this, JAMB's cutoff mark had been 200 across board over the years. And Mr. Odukoya, we don't have that 180. You just said 260 for pole science in your university.
No, I'm just giving you an
idea.
It's usually within the average anyway.
Oh, okay.
No, let me just address one thing. No, it has not. So JAMB has always, in the last maybe six, seven years, JAMB has always been talking about 180.
Okay.
As a benchmark for their cutoff. UNILAG has always been 200. Again, universities don't have the same demand. I can tell you as I'm talking, this last JAMB, in the University of Lagos, we have over 38,000 students that has, let's say, 200 and above. And we can only accommodate barely 8,000. So, how do you do it? And again, too, when the minister talks about having confidence in JAMB, with all due respect, I think he must be using a different university than we know. A different dictionary from the one we are familiar with.
All right.
If you have an examination body that just conducted an exam, and in the process of conducting the exam, the computer system for most of the students were not working. And the examination body, after the exam, has to award 40 marks across board to several of these students. What credibility, what confidence are you having in that system?
40 marks across because of the computer malfunction? Is that it?
What confidence? Was the examination done overnight? Was there no preparation? You can have be talking about confidence in an examination body that cannot simply...
What if JAMB were to be decentralized? Would that help?
JAMB has no business in admitting students for university.
Is there any way JAMB can be restructured or strengthened to be more effective and efficient?
It is not about restructuring. Somebody has a cancer within his body, and I'm saying JAMB is a cancerous institution for university. It has no business in a proper setup for education. The university is an autonomous body that should be left alone.
I understand when you say that, making comparison between Nigeria and what is obtainable across the world. But the point there is that every country has the right to adopt its own system. Must Nigeria education system be like the one in the United States or the, like you mentioned, the Harvard University? Must it be like the ones in UK and
all that? We are not even talking about content. At that level, you can say this is what we want to teach and things like that. We are talking about the university is an ideal, it's a global idea as to a body set up to impart knowledge freely on encumbrance by any other person. In terms of who comes into the university and what you teach and you don't teach, it's an idea and it's not a Nigerian idea, that's one. Mm. Then two, let me equally say, the post-UTME does equally not exclude this issue of catchment or even educationally disadvantaged. We still equally accommodate it. But it will be after you have actually gone through this process and we are sure, you are good enough to be a student in this university. That's the issue.
Okay.
Right. So it's not a situation as if we are copying what is our book. And of course, like we said, the university, the whole idea about university is universal.
Okay. All right, you're watching TVC Breakfast and we are discussing the policy somersault and the content and the implications of the Joint Admissions and Matriculation Board exams when it comes to administration of the examination and post-UTME. And we have in the studio, we've been discussing with the chairman of the Academic Staff Union of Universities, Lagos State University of Lagos chapter, Adelaja Odukoya. Now, apart from students getting into the university, how would you assess the quality of what is churned out of the university now at the other side of things, leaving the whoever is qualified for JAMB or not qualified for UTME as the case may be?
Basically, every university has its own examination process through which we assess our students. After our exams, for example, in the University of Lagos, we run a cost system. And the implication of that is that within the semester, we have what we call continuous assessments, which could be impromptu. It could be based on a pre-planned, and 40% actually. So the implication of that is that the students are forever prepared. They are just like a Boy Scout. You have to be ready. So you keep on reading because you don't know. The lecturer might decide to bring test or the CA, and it's 40%. And then we have the examination proper, which you see for at the end of the semester, 60%. So, after the first, for example, in the first year for...
But you're saying that students still don't shortchange the system because there are issue of expo, there are issue of even lecturers, even being compromised, even giving students chips, microchips, some university will say, and they come out with first degree, second degree, and they cannot defend that.
The truth is that, yes, there is no perfect system anywhere. We must be honest with ourselves. But the truth is that it is not possible to have a first class through that process. Because that's the beauty of the course system. No single lecturer will take a course or all the courses. For example, in the Department of Political Science, maybe let's talk about first year program. Basically, you have to do at least 6 or 7 courses, which is not just within the department, across several departments, and that is equally why it's a university. It's a university education, you tap from everywhere. So there's no way you compromise everybody in political science, you compromise everybody in economics, go to sociology, psychology.
Those ones are general courses. Now, when some of those courses are general courses, your core courses carry more points. Core courses carry more points.
No place.
The point there is there are elective courses.
Your core courses carry more points.
Just wait. It is not automatic that core courses carry more points. It depends on the structure of those courses, and if you are borrowing those courses, there is a minimum unit that a student needs to pass. So it is the summation. It depends if you are even having elective. If you are coming to post science, for instance, from psychology, all our courses are 3 units. Okay. Even if your own and we have courses in sociology, there are 2 units. So if you're coming to post science, you have to do 3-unit course. Okay. So it is not automatic.
It doesn't matter whatever course you're taking.
It depends on the department and the structure of their courses.
All right. Adelaja Odukoya, thank you very much for coming on the program. And we wish you well and wish the university system well and we wish Nigeria well.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. For